In this video, I'm going to give you a tour of the basic outline of where you will find things in RStudio. Now, there are two different versions you may be using, RStudio Cloud or the desktop version of RStudio. Once you know about projects, they are going to be functionally the same in the way they look, minus how they indicate projects and how you open and close a project. I'll first show you the differences, and then we'll get into looking at the layouts in one of the versions. So here I am now in my RStudio Cloud. Now in your workspace or your class or your group workspace, you will always have a list of all the different projects. So when you want to open one, for example, in my workspace, we're looking at that RStudio tour. So under my projects list, let's find this RStudio tour. I will click on it and it's going to open the project. Now in RStudio, this process is going to be a little bit different for the desktop version. So notice it says RStudio Tour. Now I'm going to open up my desktop version of R, and you're going to notice that this looks basically the same. Console, terminal, jobs, file, edit, code. On the other side, same thing. Environment, history, connections, tutorials. But where it says files, it looks different. Here, this is rooted under a folder called project, and right now all it has is the history and the .rproj file. Here, this looks like it's in a directory on my computer, which it is. RStudio, the desktop version, will have a default directory for you, and we'll also notice that it says I currently do not have a project open. So we need to manually open a project, and we might need to physically create one for ourselves. You do not need to be in a project to work in RStudio on the desktop version. I can click and write things here now in the console, for example, all that I want. However, that is not a good system to use. I recommend that for everything you're working on in RStudio, if you're using the desktop version, that you create a folder, you put a .rproj link in it, and always open and close what you're working on from the project, just like you would in RStudio Cloud. So just very quickly, if I wanted to do this, I will go File, then I will make a new project. Now, I do not have a folder for this, so I will create a new directory, but I could put it in a folder that already existed. If I had already been working, for example, on my assignment using some files that I needed in a different program. Let's go to New Directory. Now I'm going to open a new project. We're going to call this RStudio Tour, and I can decide where I want to put it. Let's just leave it here as a subdirectory in my Google Drive. I'm going to create a project, and now we'll see that it says RStudio Tour here, where it used to say projects none, and now the directory for files is rooted in my Google Drive in a folder called RStudio Tour, and it currently has the .rproj file in it. It doesn't have all of the files in the random directory that it defaults to. Now, when I want to work on this particular RStudio Tour project, I would do this by going open project or close project, depending on what I was doing. You can also look at recent projects if you want to open one. I highly recommend you don't open files, you open projects when you're using the desktop version. But now that we're in a project that's rooted into a folder, we're now functionally the same as using RStudio Cloud. So let's just go back to RStudio Cloud. Now we'll notice that there are a bunch of different parts. So here we have our menus, which work like normal in menus. File, where we can open and close and save things. Edit, copy, paste, cut, undo, redo. Code, view, plots. So these ones you'll be using as you get more familiar with R, but basics, file, and edit works the same way they do in any other program. Here we have the console. Now the console is special because once we write in it and hit enter, it will automatically run what we've done. So 2 plus 2, it's going to put 4. If I do not want it to run what I'm writing automatically, maybe I'm writing something long, I'm editing something and I want to try out different parts, I can create a .r file, which is basically like a text file for R code. So I can go either file, new file, R script, or I can go here, click on this new file, R script, and now I have basically a text pad. If I go 2+2 and hit return, nothing happens. 3+5, nothing happens. I don't get any results. Now currently this is untitled. Let's see what happens when I save it. So let's save this. Let's call this R test. And now it's going to appear as a file in that project directory. Awesome. So I have multiple R codes. I can have multiple text pads that will appear as different tabs. If I create a new one, we'll see it's just going to create a new tab there for me. Now, if I have something here in my .R that I want to be run in the console, I can highlight it and hit run. I highlight both of these and hit run. Now it'll run both lines of code. So you can write a line, run it. That's not quite what I want. Tweak it and hit run again. Other important things we're going to look at is here the history. So see, the history is keeping track of everything that I've run in the console. In the environment, currently it is empty because I have not created any objects. What this does is it keeps track of the objects you've made and what is inside of them. So let's quickly make an object called X, and we'll make it a vector that contains the numbers 1, 2, 3, and 4. So let's run this. I've run it in the console. Now, suddenly in the global environment, it has X, tells me it's numeric, and it has the numbers 1 through 4. So if I run X here in the console and hit enter, it's going to print the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. Now let's look at what happens when I go 2 times X. It prints out 2 times X, which would be 2, 4, 6, 8. However, in the global environment, X is still the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4 because we didn't actually update the value of X. But if I went X is equal to 2 times X, now it's going to update it to be 2, 4, 6, 8, because X has been assigned to be the value of 2 times the previous value of X. So this will just help us keep track of what we've done. Next, we have plots. So any plots that I make are going to appear here. So I had some old plots saved, but let's make a new one. So say I go histogram of X. Now R includes right endpoints, but not left endpoints. So this would include the numbers 2 through 4. This would include the number 6. This would include the number 8. So I have 2 here, a 6, and an 8. Now if I want to save this, I can use the export tool. I can save it as an image. I can save it as a PDF, or I can copy it to the clipboard. This will save it to my computer. I can also go here, that .r file, if I wanted to take it off RStudio Cloud, I could go more and I could choose export. Now if I make multiple plots, so say I make a plot of X with X, so this takes that vector X and just plots the points using the first entry of X as both the X and the Y, the second value is the X and the Y, etc. So 2, 2, 4, 4, 6, 6, 8, 8. Now I can go back and forth between the plots that I've made. Packages. So packages contain extra commands that you might want to use that other people have written. They're loaded in separately because oftentimes packages will use variable names that other people used in other packages. As anyone can create a package, there's nothing that prevents me from making a package that calls something cats where someone else also has a package that calls something cat. So we can decide which ones we want loaded. So this tells me all of the packages I have installed, and things with checkmark tells me which ones I have loaded. So if I want to use this package class, I can click and it will load the package class. If I don't want to use it anymore, I can unclick it. If I want to install a new package, I can click on install. So there's one package I know, E1071. I start typing it. I say, I want to install this package. Now we are going to give it a second. Packages, when we try to install them, They are going to take longer than other things in order to install. So now it says install package E1071. Notice I have this cursor here. I do not have the greater than symbol that I normally do. This means R is running. It's very important when you're installing things in R that you do not touch anything until you see that cursor, unless it's a prompt that wants you to click yes or no or okay or not okay. So we will just sit here and wait a second while it installs. Now I have that symbol and the cursor. It's done. I can do other things now. So notice it installed it, but it didn't load it. So I can click and that will load it so that I can use the functions in E1071. We can either do this by clicking, or let's see, I unclick it, but I can type in the command library E1071. And suddenly it becomes clicked. So I can either use library detaches commands or I can click and unclick here. I recommend that you use the library command and write it into your code so that every time you start, you just run all of your code and it installs all the packages you need. If someone else is using your code, then they can also just run your code and it will install all the packages that it needs, as opposed to trying to remember which ones you need to click and unclick every single time that you use a file. So these are the basics of what you're going to be using. There are more advanced features that I haven't gone over. For example, our terminal, which is an actual terminal like you were using on a computer. You'll also be able to do things like make connections to GitHub as well. But those will be more advanced things. This is enough to get you going and the basics of our layout in RStudio, both RStudio Cloud and the desktop version.